Today, March 2, 2019, is Concorde's 50th anniversary since her first flight. Concorde was absolutely the gold standard of aviation. She was a masterpiece of engineering and one of the world's most beautiful creations. Let's celebrate the Concorde in this video. Concorde was an icon of beauty, style, and in her own way, a brand. Every aspect of the aircraft was designed for aerodynamic efficiency, and yet the outcome became something truly elegant, instantly recognizable all over the world. Concorde was a cliché queen, flying on the edge of space, faster than a rifle bullet, and from her windows, you can see the curvature of the Earth. Concorde was able to overtake the sun, and in some months, one can arrive before they set off. You can literally buy back time. My ultimate flight was on board the Supersonic Concorde in 2003. I flew the Concorde flight in April 17, 2003. It's about 6 months before the final retirement. I flew on British Airways BA002 from JFK to Heathrow in just 3 hours 18 minutes crossing the Atlantic at 58,000 feet and twice the speed of the sound. Coming into Concorde makes me remember a lot of memories. At that time I couldn't make a video, I didn't have a video camera, but I took a lot of good pictures to share with you. First thing I noticed the Concorde is the ceiling is a little bit lower than the normal one. You notice how little the window is to look out. So on my Concorde flights, we have about 54 passengers. Concorde takes 100 passengers. There's 40 in the forward cabin like this, and then 60 in the aft cabin. I was sitting in 12 Delta, aft cabin window seat, so just directly one row behind the first row, like this. We took off on runway 13 right, which is not a very usual runway for the Concorde to take off on. And I remember the takeoff speed was much faster than a subsonic airplane. We took about 3/4 of the runway. The runway was really long, 14,000 foot, so we took about 9,000 foot to get airborne. Once we airborne, we took a steep right turn over and to avoid the land to fly over towards Long Island. And it was a bit cloudy day, so within a few minutes after takeoff, we lost completely sight of the land and we were already over the ocean. The plane was very narrow and it's not a lay flat seat or a fully sleeper seat because you don't need it. It's only 3 hours you transatlantic across the pond. There are businessmen coming on board that, you know, they fly the same day return and back home, and this was possible because of Supersonic Concorde. So I remember after takeoff we reached speed of sound, which is Mach 1 at 28,500 feet. Continuing increasing the speed, we reached Mach 2 at 48,000 feet, and we continue in Mach 2 for about over 2 hours across the Atlantic. Our final cruising altitude was 58,000 feet. The Mach 2 on the Concorde stretched 10 feet during the flight. Outside on the body is extremely hot, and you can feel the heat a little bit. You also might ask, Sam, have you heard of the sonic boom on the Concorde? Because a lot of myth and popular belief think when the Concorde break through the barrier sound traveling over Mach 1, you might hear a sonic boom. My answer is not really. I didn't remember much, honestly. There are ships over the Atlantic constantly can hear the Concorde traveling over the speed of sound and hear the sonic boom throughout, you know, the sky, but I couldn't hear inside the cabin myself. The service on the Concorde was better than most first class service. We had a 3 hour flight, we had a brunch served with caviar, lobster cake, and very nice cheese and red wine. It was the best dining British Airways had at that time. Steward and stewardess were specially selected just to serve the Concorde flight. They were very polite and very efficient. During my flight, I made a few friends on board. There were people traveling from all over the world, from Australia, from South Africa, and there were people bringing their kids to enjoy the Concorde. And about 30 minutes before coming to land, Captain Mike Bannister came on the PA and said, the weather is unusually seasonally warm in London, 26 degrees. We have an easterly wind. So we flew over the Windsor Castle while we coming to land at Heathrow. There was a tremendous pride and tremendous proud feeling inside me while we landed at Heathrow. The landing speed was much faster on the Concorde than other planes. It almost felt like we had priority on the landing sequence. And after landing, I got to go to the cockpit to meet Captain Mike Bannister, who's the chief Concorde pilot at that time. And he was such a gentleman, he signed my logbook and my certificates. And up to this day, I keep them intact in my treasure case. At that time, the ticket price I paid was about $3,000. So think about it, it burns you about $1,000 per hour. Is it worth it? Totally, because there's nothing like it. There's no other really airplane like the Concorde. You can fly at this fast, at this high, and have the ultimate flight of your time.
Welcome to Brooklands Museum, the home of Concorde, the world's premier supersonic passenger jet. Here behind me is Concorde Golf Bravo Bravo Delta Golf. Delta Golf was the third Concorde built in the UK. She was a demonstration aircraft. She was used in the summer of 1975 for training the first generation of British Airways Concorde pilots. And she did most of the test flying to obtain the certificate of airworthiness. In other words, it's licensed to carry passengers. And it's during that phase that Delta Golf became truly immortal, because she was the first Concorde and therefore the first aircraft in history to carry 100 passengers at twice the speed of sound. Okay folks, so this is the forward door. Passengers would enter the aircraft from the terminal through an air bridge and into this forward door. And inside we're going to turn left into the flight deck.
Well, you know guys, the Concorde door is a bit low, so you have to duck when you come in. Oh, this is it. We're inside a Concorde.
Okay, so welcome to the flight deck everyone. As you can see, this is slightly different to a modern flight deck. All of the instruments are analog instruments. This is more akin to a fighter jet than a modern airliner. Modern airliners, of course, are all glass cockpits. The central panel here that you see are all engine instruments, engine 1, 2, 3 and 4. And on the left-hand side and the right-hand side in front of the captain and the first officer, we have a traditional conventional flight deck arrangement with our navigational instruments, altitude indicator, airspeed indicator and compasses and navigational equipment. Up on the top here we've got the autopilot panel with our speed hold, altitude hold and all the other controls that are designed to make pilots' lives a little bit easier. As everyone knows, Concorde flew at twice the speed of sound, so it has a very special instrument that you will not find on a normal commercial airliner, which is a Mach meter. Concorde flew at Mach 2, which is twice the speed of sound, and this instrument here measures the aircraft speed against the speed of sound. Now, at the front of the aircraft, we have one of Concorde's defining features, which, as you can see, is a visor with very sloped back panels and the nose cone. And in order for the pilots to see where they're going at low speeds, because the aircraft is rotated at a very high angle, both the visor and the nose would droop down, so that when the aircraft is at a steep angle to fly slowly for takeoff and landing, the pilots had a good chance of seeing where they were going. That's a unique feature on Concorde, which of course you won't find on any other aircraft. Unique Concorde feature, which is the visor retractor. So at the moment is in the fully up position. The next notch is for the visor to be retracted into the nose cone. Then we have the 5 degrees down, where the whole nose assembly droops down 5 degrees. And finally, we have the fully down position, where the nose is drooped 12.5 degrees.
This yoke here is like a specially designed for the Concorde. It's like a fighter jet yoke.
It's a different shape to the yoke that you'd find on most commercial airliners. Mm. So yes, it is a slightly different shape and very unique. This is the landing gear lever here. The knob here is shaped like a wheel.
Yeah.
And if you were on a conventional airliner, you'd have a flap lever, and that flap lever is shaped like a flap. Right. So it's a little bit of intuition, if you like.
Mm.
Okay, so here we have the thrust lever assembly. So the handle on the top here after the thrust levers, and the throttles move forward like this. And on the front of the thrust levers, we have the reverse thrusters. So when the aircraft has landed on the ground, the nose wheel is back onto the runway. The captain raises the reverse thrust levers to slow the aircraft down. Now on the reverse of the thrust levers, we have thrust levers that operate the same as these, and these ones are operated by the flight engineer, as are the reheat switches here, which switch on the reheats to give Concorde that extra 20% of power for takeoff and also to pass through the speed of sound.
The takeoff I have on the Concorde was a bit different to other airplanes, because after about 1 minute 40 seconds, I remembered I felt deceleration. It's because the captains, they turn off the reheat because we were still over land while we just took off from New York. So this is try to create less noise and then also less power. And when it started crossing the ocean, when it started to increase the speed, then they turned back on the reheats to accelerate the aircraft to supersonic level.
Okay, so this is the front cabin, ladies and gentlemen. This is the forward cabin of the aircraft. There were 40 seats in here. This is exactly as it was when the aircraft was in service. Okay, so here's the rear of the forward cabin. We're now going to go through the midships toilet area and into this area here, where we have a pair of seats from each of the decades that Concorde was in service. Down to your left there is the seats that were in use when the aircraft first went into service in the 1970s. Then on the right is a pair of seats from the 1980s. In the middle here is a pair of seats from the 1990s, which are the ones that you saw in the forward cabin. And finally, a pair of these beautiful blue leather seats, which were installed in the aircraft following the terrible accident in Paris, designed to save weight, to make up for the fact that the fuel tanks had to be lined with Kevlar in order to protect against another accident of the type that happened in Paris. Okay, folks, so this is the rear cabin of Delta Golf. What we have in here, in place of the 60 seats that would have been in here when the aircraft was in service, lots of information about Concorde as she was being designed, as she was being built, when she went into service, and then the retirement program after that terrible accident in Paris. And here, this is a window from Concorde. As you'll see, they're very small. The reason the Concorde windows were made very small is in order to reduce the rate of decompression in the event of a window breakage, which could have been catastrophic given the pressure differential inside the aircraft compared to outside at 60,000 feet. You'll see how small the windows are compared to a modern aircraft, and you'll also see some little brown pipes here which circulate cool, dry air in between the two panes of glass to reduce condensation and to keep the inside panes of glass cooler, because the aircraft heated up to quite high temperatures at supersonic flight. 90 miles of wiring that every Concorde contained. Those wiring looms were actually constructed here at Brooklands, along with one third of the airframe of all of the 20 Concordes. Okay, so here we are at the rear of the rear cabin in the aircraft, and this area to the rear contains the galley, which obviously is not here anymore. And then beyond the galley, behind a bulkhead, is the baggage hold. The door that you see on the left there is not a passenger entrance, it's where the baggage handlers loaded the baggage. And beyond that we have the rear fuel tank. Okay folks, so welcome to the Concorde simulator. This building was the original acoustics building at Brooklands Museum, where materials were tested for soundproofing. The Concorde simulator was originally at Filton in Bristol at the British Airways Engineering Base. It was moved here after being taken out of service in 2003. So here we have a real Concorde check-in desk. So when you flew Concorde, this is where you would come and check in. So this is the only one ever used in the UK. All 134 pilots and 57 flight engineers were trained in this very simulator.
So guys, now I am taking the Concorde for a takeoff run out of runway 27 London Heathrow. Let's go, guys. I felt the speed was much faster than a normal plane. Positive climb. Coming to land Heathrow, 27 left.
Today is the 50th anniversary of the very first flight of the first Concorde. Took off from Toulouse-Blagnac 50 years ago and made a short flight prior to landing. And it was amazing to think that that aeroplane still looks futuristic today.
To go to work as a Concorde pilot, of course, was just the most privileged, best job in the world. The aeroplane had to perform very precisely, very accurately. It was a day out with your mates every time you went to work, because we were such a small group of people, we all knew one another very well. So now I'm still very proud, still thoroughly enjoy my work, even though I'm approaching retirement. So when I go to work and fly the Boeing 777, it's a modern fly-by-wire aeroplane, using a lot of the technology that was developed in Concorde. apart from stating the obvious, to take such a bloody long time to get anywhere compared to Concorde.
I was extremely fortunate to become a crew member on board and worked under the guidance of a crew in their 40s, senior crew, who'd been BOAC crew. They taught me an awful lot. I learned a lot about etiquette on board, fine wines, Dom Perignon, Montrachet Premier Cru, Chateau Talbot, about passengers, VIP passengers, royalty. It was incredible.
Here's Captain Mike Bannister. He actually flown me in 2003 on my only supersonic flight from JFK to Heathrow. I'm really, really happy to see you, Captain, today.
Well, here we are at Brooklands on the 50th anniversary of the first ever Concorde flight, 50 years ago today, the 2nd of March 1969. And we've reached the point where we're about to lower the nose and visor of our Concorde, Golf Bravo, Bravo, Delta Golf. And we're going to do it at exactly the same time as the first Concorde ever lifted off, 50 years ago to the moment. So that's going to be a real celebration.
Amazing. Thank you, sir.
I flew on Concorde on the 15th of October 2003. Such a momentous event in my life that the date has become like a second birthday. I remember we took off at 6 p.m. in darkness, and with a 3.5 hour flight and a -5 hour time difference, it meant that we actually caught up with the sun and landed in daylight at 4:30 p.m. off the ground at Heathrow at 6, on the deck in New York 4:30. So actual time travel. And flying high enough that the night was a shadow through the sky, which we flew out of. And for that not only to be possible, but to be accessible to the general public is absolutely unbelievable and shows how far ahead of the time the aircraft was.
Yeah, many years ago I used to go across Heathrow and stop for lunch breaks, and it was lucky enough it was a time when they used to take off. So all the traffic stopped everywhere just to stand and watch it go. It was brilliant, absolutely fantastic. Like I say, the ground shook, everybody just looked at it. You could not stop looking at it until it disappeared.
A flight on board a Concorde is like no other flight. I think you will agree with me. What a beautiful, glorious looking aircraft she is. And Concorde, undeniably, is a beautiful part of aviation history. And I hope the supersonic travel returns in the sky one day in the future.